It's pure ideology.
Meet Manish Sabharwal. If you don't recognize his name or his face, you might be wondering, where have I seen this guy before? I'm sure I've seen him playing a dentist in some random toothpaste commercial, right? Unfortunately for the world, Manish Sabharwal does not sell toothpaste. But he does sell something else. See, Manish is a vendor of ideology, a salesman of neoliberal thought in the free marketplace of ideas. And he's pretty good at it too. So good that he's found his way into the board of directors of the Reserve Bank of India. Not to mention being a member of the National Skill Mission, in addition to his main job as the chairman of Team Lease Services, which is described as India's largest staffing and human capital firm. He is also a columnist for the Indian Express. Those wishing to understand and maybe even emulate Manish's remarkable success as an apostle of the free market are confronted with the question, what makes him so good at his job? Sure, he's a certified business genius who learned the craft at the same B school as Warren Buffett, Sundar Pichai, and Donald Trump. But that boardroom cred is almost entirely cancelled out by his insufferably smug, self-satisfied aura. Nevertheless, scholars have pored over Manish's voluminous writings and public utterances, and some have argued that it is his way with words, his rhetorical flourishes, that set him apart. One notable aspect of his writing and speaking style is his extensive use of metaphors, which, as we all know, is a trademark high IQ move. The only downside is that sometimes his metaphors and analogies just fly over the heads of pathetic, pea-brain, low IQ lowlifes, but one can hardly expect such people to understand the mind of a man who can only be described as the love child of Confucius and Gordon Gekko. Consider the following excerpt from an email interview with Manish published in Mint last year on the topic of economic development in Kashmir. Economic development is like a game of Scrabble. The more letters you have, the more words you can make, and the more longer words you can make. And the government provides the vowels. J&K does not have enough private sector letters, and politics hasn't produced enough vowels. Because it is insufficiently urbanized, financialized, formalized, and industrialized. Get it? I don't, but it sounds smart, and for every 1,000 dumb f**ks like me, there must be at least one genius policy wonk who is bowled over by Manish's profound insights. And surely, that justifies all the wealth, power, and influence he wields in our society, right? Students of the Manish Sabharwal School of Thought, however, will urge us to look beyond how Manish says things to the things he says, as it is the latter that show his true brilliance. As one profile put it, Manish is highly respected for his clear thinking and analysis, and one can find abundant examples of such analysis in nearly every one of his columns for the Indian Express, like when he wrote in the paper a couple of months ago regarding post-independence India's economic policies that socialism is essentially capitalism without competition. Boom! In just 6 words, Manish destroys socialism with an ultra-hot take socialists have obviously never, ever, ever encountered before. It's not like a regular R India user who socialists usually argue with online could ever display the capacity for rigorous thinking and objective analysis required to come up with that. This is just one example, of course, but Manish's work is littered like dog poop on the pavement with countless moments where he showcases his famed originality of thought. There are, however, certain cynics who relate Manish's success as a neoliberal evangelist not to the qualities just mentioned, but to something quite different. This minority group within the larger Manish Sabharwal fandom is of the opinion that Manish's reputation as the go-to guy for sensible policy measures primarily rests on two distinct tendencies that are apparent in his writings and interviews. The first, the cynics tell us, is to rail against vested interests, usually farm and trade unions, that are impeding reforms by clinging on to the status quo. In this way, he is able to characterize these groups as enemies of progress and prosperity, whose opposition to reforms, that is to the neoliberal project, does not stem from any concern about the people they are supposed to represent, but is in fact an expression of political opportunism and a bid to preserve the status in the current order of things. In contrast to these short-sighted, power-hungry vested interests, Manish positions himself as the cool, rational observer whose only goal is the prosperity of all. And this is the second strand the cynics focus on. In all that he says, there is no acknowledgement or perhaps even comprehension of class interest, and it is instinctively assumed that there is no conflict between his interests as the CEO of a major corporation and those of, let's say, a landless agricultural laborer in Jharkhand. Whatever is good for capital, and big capital in particular, is good for all. That is the basic premise of Manish's worldview. The cynics are quick to add that both these tendencies are not unique to Manish, nor is he the first one to employ them to preach bourgeois ideology. Despite this, they don't miss any opportunity to mock and ridicule him, like recently when they pounced upon a snippet from an interview where Manish is speaking about protests against the government's farm bills and claimed it as yet another proof of their so-called thesis.
Usually if you do a reform and nobody screams and shouts, that means that it's not usually very impactful. So the level of opposition to agricultural reform suggests that this is very impactful reform.
To normal people like you and I, this statement is a simple historical fact. After all, when Indira Gandhi declared the emergency, all the screaming and shouting in opposition to it was actually a vindication of her bold reforms, wasn't it? And wasn't the screaming and shouting we know today as the Quit India movement partly a response to the bold decision of the British to drag India into the Second World War? How silly we Indians were back then. We just didn't know that protesting something is actually proving that the other party is right. Thanks to Manish, we know that now, and we can gather innumerable examples from history to demonstrate the same. However, this totally logical statement has been interpreted by some people as an attempt to delegitimize the protests by either implying that vested interests have misled farmers and hence the protests must be ignored, or maybe admitting that the protests are somewhat genuine, but those simple-minded farmers just don't know how good the bills are for them. But they are good because they are good for big capital and by definition good for everyone else. I implore you, dear viewer, to not be swayed even slightly by the childish arguments put forward by the cynics. You should believe Manish when he says that the farm bills are a stepping stone towards Purna Swaraj for our farmers. In fact, don't even listen to any arguments against Manish or what he stands for, because he's always right. Well, not always, because I did find myself disagreeing slightly with one thing he said in that Wire interview.
I have a fundamental problem in believing that India has a jobs problem. We have a wages problem. If you think India has a jobs problem, which means bhuka nanga pyasa, you'll throw money from helicopters, you'll mandate a three-day work week. But I think everybody who wants a job has a job, so we have a wages problem.
Everybody who wants a job has a job. It's true, of course, in a general sense that 3 to 3.5 crore working age people today are unemployed because they don't want jobs. They're just too lazy to work. Of course, everybody who wants a job has a job. But where I disagree with Manish is that not everybody has the job they deserve. Because I truly believe that he deserves a better, much more important job than all the ones he has right now. The job of leading this country to unimaginable riches. The United States appointed a great businessman to run their country, and look how well they're doing. If India wishes to be a superpower like the US one day, we need to do the same. And that is why I believe Manish Sabharwal would make a great Prime Minister. One that would run the country like a business. Because isn't a country exactly like a business? And the CEO and the board exactly like the PM and his cabinet? And it's about time we had a small, efficient government that puts all its efforts in looking out for its most important citizens, the few biggest shareholders, the ones who pay most of the taxes and the ones who create all the jobs. And not pander to those hundreds of millions who contribute next to nothing. Just their pathetic labor which keeps the world running, that's all. And they aren't even satisfied getting paid for their work. No, these parasites want free food and livable wages. The nerve on some of these folks. I can't wait until Manish becomes the Prime Minister and gives working people a choice. Those freeloaders either work 24 hours a day without breaks and without pay, or they'll be replaced by machines. It's simple. I mean, if they can't even compete with machines, then obviously we don't have to care about what happens to them. Let the free market decide. But whatever their fate, at least they will meet it knowing they had a taste of Purna Swaraj.